Apostles. Peter said to Cornelius and his household, "You surely know what happened everywhere in Judea. It began in Galilee after John had told everyone to be baptized. God gave the Holy Spirit and power to Jesus from Nazareth. He was with Jesus as he went around doing good and healing everyone who was under the power of the devil. We all saw what Jesus did, both in Israel and in the city of Jerusalem. Jesus was put to death on the cross, but 3 days later, God raised him to life and let him be seen. Not everyone saw him. He was seen only by us, who ate and drank with him after he was raised from the dead, from death. We were the one God chose to tell others about him. God told us to announce clearly to the people that Jesus is the one he has chosen to judge the living and the dead. Every one of the prophets has said that all who have faith in Jesus will have their sins forgiven in his name. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Praise the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Reading from the letter of Paul to Colossians. Brothers and sisters, you have been raised to life with Christ. Now set your hearts on what is in heaven, where Christ rules at God's right side. Think about which is up there, not about what is here on earth. You died, which means that your life is hidden with Christ, who sits beside God. Christ gives meaning to your life, and when he appears, you will also appear with him in glory. Christians, to the Paschal victim, offer your thankful praise. A lamb, the sheep, redeems. Christ, who only is sinless, reconciles sinners to the Father. Death and life have contended in the combat stupendous. It's Prince of Life, who died and reigns immortal. Speak, Mary, declaring what you saw. Wayfaring the tomb of Christ, who is living, the glory of Jesus' resurrection. Bright angels attesting the shroud and napkin resting. Yes, Christ, my hope, is arisen. To Galilee he goes before you. Christ indeed from death is risen, our new life obtaining. Have mercy, victory king. Ever reigning. reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. On Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran to Simon Peter and to Jesus' favorite disciple and said, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb. We don't know where they have put him." Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. They ran side by side until the other disciple ran faster than Peter and got there first. He bent over and saw the strips of linen cloth lying inside the tomb, but he did not go in. When Simon Peter got there, he went into the tomb and saw the strips of cloth. He also saw the pieces of cloth that had been used to cover Jesus' face. It was rolled up and in a place by itself. The disciples who got there first, then, went into the tomb, and when he saw it, he believed. At that time, Peter and the other disciples did not know that the scriptures said Jesus would rise to life. It would seem by the looks of it outside that Jesus has in fact not seen his shadow, and winter is gone. For those of you who know the story of the light, the witch, and the wardrobe, know that the arrival of Aslan began at thaw through Narnia, and after his sacrifice on the stone table, he was able to put an end to the white witch and along with her winter. The dates of Christmas and Easter both play on them on the theme of light. The birthday of Jesus was superimposed on the winter solstice, which signals the time when the night stops growing long and begins to recede. The arrival of Jesus breaks his stranglehold on that night and darkness on the world, with Easter, which always takes place after the vernal equinox, that time when the day finally becomes equal, then longer than the night. We are reminded of the definitive victory of Christ over the night and darkness of our lives. In fact, the council that gave us the creed determined three criteria for the calculation of Easter. The first Sunday after the first full moon after spring. Spring was on March 21st. The full moon happened last Wednesday, and now Sunday, the weekly anniversary of that first day of the week when God said, "Let there be light." We've anticipated this twice already during Lent. On the second Sunday, we heard the story of Jesus' transfiguration. His face and clothing shone with such brightness that Peter, James, and John had to turn their faces away from him. Then, on the fourth Sunday, Jesus heals the man born blind, who is able to see because of the true light that only Jesus can give. I am the light of the world, said the Lord. Recently, my Facebook wall was full of people complaining about how spring had not yet arrived because it was still snowing. But spring, in fact, has nothing to do with grass and trees and flowers, but everything to do with light. We Edmontonians have a special appreciation for the sun's warmth and light, and perhaps more than most cities in North America. We talk about vitamin D, aptly called the sunshine vitamin, and we all know the effects of vitamin D deficiency. Many, many people, I submit to you, suffer from a far worse condition, spiritual vitamin D deficiency. It is the condition of the soul that seeks to block out the light of Christ because one is afraid of what they might see. Much like how people who feel sorry for themselves sit for hours on a stool in a dark bar as a way of escaping from themselves. If Christ is our light, then surely he gives us spiritual vitamin D. The sun, we know, helps our bones to grow, keeps our heart healthy, and supports our immune system. An analogy is the Son of God, pun intended, gives us a kind of life that moves beyond mere survival to that of flourishing. As Saint Irenaeus of Lyon so famously said, the glory of God is the human person fully alive, and this abundance of life cannot be handed apart from Christ. So if the risen Christ gives us light, how can we get it? It is no poetics when the church speaks of the Easter sacrament, baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist, although they were instituted during the life of Jesus. They were not empowered and given to us until Good Friday. The water and blood flowing from Jesus' pierced side, says St. John, symbolizes baptism and the Eucharist. Then he gave up his spirit. Actually, the Greek New Testament says he handed over the spirit. And that's confirmations. The gap of time between Jesus then and us now is closed, thanks to the resurrection. When Father Jim lit the Easter candle last night, he said, all time belongs to him, and all ages. The glorified body of the risen Christ made him immune to the limitations of time, and because of that, he is not just everywhere, but everywhere. Most of us here this morning have already received the Easter sacrament. The challenge now is to conscientiously and intentionally go about receiving Christ's light when we renew our baptism promises, as we will in just a moment, and when we come to the Lord's table to partake of his sacred body and precious blood. And those of you who are guests and visitors here this morning, welcome. But even more than that, the risen Christ welcomes you and earnestly invites you to share in his life which alone can shed light on human conditions. As the Archbishop of Edmonton said several years ago, Jesus Christ alone is the answer to the question that is every human life. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who lived in the land of gloom, a light has shone. Awake, O sleeper, arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you light. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. pressure of bishop and all clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and in praise and glorifying you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
And